church.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you again and to have a special time of sacred worship together. Thank you for some of you struggling through that second hymn, which is a challenge, but if you get bored during my sermon, go back and look at it in terms of the words are very powerful.
Amen.
One of the challenges I've had after heart surgery was not being able to sing as well as I never sang well, but I sang loud. And so I was challenged with that, although I'm always mindful for those of you who don't sing that because you've got a bad voice. The quip from my Old Testament professor said, when people said they can't sing because they have a bad voice, he said, well, God gave you that voice, let God listen to it. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto thee. As we come, O God, in this moment of this time to reflect upon the word that you would have for us this day, we offer up these prayers in Christ's name. Amen. We're turning our attention this morning to the seventh beatitude. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Or as the message, which I lifted up last week, particularly contemporary version of the Bible, Eugene Peterson writes, you are blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. And what I want us to do this morning is invite you, before we actually reflect upon this text, let us see if we can be first in our right mind and spirit. Seeking one level here this morning to find a sense of peace for ourselves. For ourselves. We had a greeting this morning. The peace of the Lord be with you and the peace of God be with you. Jesus and the disciples often exchanged a greeting of peace, and the Apostle Paul, as well as other writers of the New Testament, their letters often begin with these words, grace to you, peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there's the departing words of Jesus to his disciples as recorded in the Gospel of John. Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Remember this moment was a moment that the disciples were very distraught and very upset. Peace I be with you. My peace I give to you. Yet I would suspect, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but I suspect most of us this morning, how much of us are, you know, peaceful. Peaceful in our own minds, in our own hearts, in our own spirits. Although one of the nice things about coming here this morning is riding across the countryside and seeing the beautiful creation that God has given us. But peace is often hard to find in this 24/7 schedule. The task, although some of us call it multitasking, of work, of schedules, caring for family members, running here and there, doctor's appointments, school, getting our kids scheduled, shopping, can easily trap us in what is called a rat race. Although Bill Coffin used to say, remember at the end of the rat race, you're still a rat. We step back for a moment this morning as we gather and worship and find a sense of God's peace. One of the gifts of retirement, and I suspect some of you are retired here, and we are blessed to have a home in Maine also that I can spend on the porch sitting, and I've had what I call some sacred silent space. Just looking up at God's good creation and just taking it all in and really finding a sense of God in the gift of the creation. Sense of peace. Think of that hymn, there is a place of quiet rest where I find my heart near to God. And so we think of peace this morning. First, we would see it in the moment of our own reflection, our own mind, our own spirit. Let there be peace on earth is our last hymn, and it goes, let there be peace on earth, but let it begin with me. Let it begin with me. Peace I give to you. Those are the words of Jesus. Other words we hear from Jesus is, come unto you, all who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We're called to find a sense of peace. Can you experience that for a moment? Now, the danger is you might fall asleep if you find it here in this hour, but I'll go there. But Jesus also admonishes us that this sense of peace that we have, we're to share it with others. We're to share it with others. And so we are called to be peacemakers. To be peacemakers. What I wish for us to do this morning is to consider the nature of peace from a biblical and a theological perspective, and in turn reflect upon peacemakers, and finally discern where we might be called to be a peacemaker. And in so doing, affirm that we are children of God. Walter Brueggemann, who is a biblical scholar and professor of Old Testament, writes these words in a little book called Biblical Reflections on Shalom, Living Toward a Vision. Brueggemann writes, the central vision of world history in the Bible is that all of creation is one, and every creature in the community with every other living harmony and security for the joy and the well-being of every other creature. He goes on to write, we are all children of a single family. We are all children of a single family. Members of a single tribe. Heirs of a single home. Bearers of a single destiny. Namely, the care and the management of God's good creation. He goes on to write, Shalom. Shalom is the substance of the biblical vision of one community embracing all creation. What we're hearing is the Hebrew word shalom, which some of us are familiar with that word. What we're hearing is that God wants us to be all one human family. One human family. We're brothers and sisters of a parent God who loves each and every one of us and turns and desires that we love each other. I love that Southern Baptist tradition, and it's also used often in the African American churches, where one greets one another as a little brother, sister, brother, and then surname. Reminds us that we're related, brothers and sisters. Now, if you've got a bad relationship with brother and sister, that may be a challenge too, but still that title of brother and sister, that we are all part of the human family.
Amen.
Well, we know right from the beginning of God's good creation, sibling rivalry begins, Cain killing Adam, or Abel, I mean. And then when he's pressed by God as to where Abel is, he says, how should I know? Am I my brother's keeper? The biblical narrative over and over again calls us to be caring for one another. Yet the reality of the human condition is the contradiction of this biblical truth. We have a hard time getting along with one another, don't we?
All right.
Amen?
All right.
Admit we're all sinners here.
Come on.
Now I'm getting along better with somebody now that I'm just passing by when I was here. I'm having trouble getting together, you know what I mean? Again, we've been blessed, as I said, with a home on an island in Maine. It's 400 acres. And it's kind of interesting culture on that island. Part of its DNA is the reality of people not able to get along with one another. In fact, they've even built a fence on one side of the island, say, some people can't go on this side, and some can't go on that other side. Nothing new that Donald Trump's suggesting, but, you know, suspense. Every so often, someone will say, you know, I don't know why we can't get along here. Why we are so close to one another, why we can't get it wrong. I become mindful that the island is a microcosm of the world in which we live. People people have a hard time getting along with one another. It's motivated by lots of factors. Hatred, jealousy, bitterness, covetousness, selfishness, prejudice. These are just some of the factors that divide us from others. And those factors often occur in family relationships, between friends, mutual acquaintances at work, at school, even here in the church. And then we hear of such brokenness in our country. Result of racism, economic class division, of political rhetoric. Thank God it'll be all over in about 3 weeks.
Amen.
We hear of prejudice towards people of other faiths. All factors that contradict God's intention for the human family. And in our world, wars continue day in, day out. In Syria, when you hear the atrocities that are going on there, in Iraq, Nigeria, Afghanistan, Sudan, Darfur, Democratic Republic, Congo, causing countless deaths every day of men and women and children. Right this morning, as we're worshiping other parts of the world, there is that terrorism that's going on. Terrorists whose ideology and hatred toward others is so hard to comprehend. Even they employ children, these suicide bombers that kill innocent people going around their daily lives. And our news cycles tell us there's acts of domestic violence, of urban gun warfare, of mass shootings, of homelessness, the plague of drug addiction. Oh, I could go on and on and on. Maybe the horrors of the human condition that we face each day. Conditions that may impact some of you personally. Conditions that create what some psychologists would call a maddening numbness. Brokenness all about us. But you know what? You know what? You and I know, it's not a secret, but you and I know, this is not who God created us to be. God's heart must break so often when God looks upon the human condition. When I have a chance to fly and get up above the clouds, it's so beautiful. Part of my thinking is that, you know, God can't look at us, so just put some of these clouds. cover it up. Yet it's this God that we hear this morning telling us, we are called to be peacemakers, to work about bringing about God's vision for the human family. The word of God for us as a people of God is, blessed are the peacemakers. Or as Peterson translated, listen to me again, you are blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete and fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. Now, this word peacemaker in the Beatitudes, seven Beatitudes, clearly defines someone who devotes himself to the work of reconciliation, reconciling hostile individuals and families and communities and groups and nations. The Hebrew word shalom implies a harmonious cooperation aimed at the welfare of all. The peacemaker is one who seeks to reconcile persons who have broken relationships, whether they be personal relationships or relationships between nations. The peacemaker tries not only to bring a truce, but a reconciliation that unites hearts and minds together. It's the recognition that indeed we are brothers and sisters, part of the human family loved by God, who in turn desires us to love one another. Writer 1 John reminds us, beloved, let us love one another. Because love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. I love when we experience our relationship with God. Or as the Beatitude reminds us, that when we're peacemakers, we're children of God. Well, the question here, as we sit and hear the words of Jesus this morning, words he gave to his disciples a couple thousand years ago on the mountaintop. Here we are, downtown Haslett. Is there a downtown Haslett? Here we are. And we hear this question. Am I a peacemaker? Are you a peacemaker? Am I a peacemaker? Do I accept that responsibility? And then the other question is, well, where do I begin? Where do I begin? I suspect a good starting point is where there might be brokenness in our own personal life. Who do you need to make peace with? Only you know where that division is in your life, in your own life, that needs healing, that needs to be made whole, that needs to be reconciled. Earlier, I invited you at this time of worship to be at peace with yourself. Now I want you to be disturbed by those words of peace. When we're reminded there's someone we need to reach out to. Someone we need to reach out to. Now that may not be true for all of us at this moment in time, anyway. Yet I suspect all of us at times, and perhaps even in this moment, hold within our hearts disdain, dislike, prejudicial attitudes for someone or some groups of persons. As peacemakers, we need to let go. Let go. For those words, let go, let God. Jesus is clear in the sermon that we are called, yes, even to love our enemies. Think of that, we're called to love our enemies. That admonition is perhaps the hardest in all of Scripture. That really was us to the test. A test that many of us at times fail. But it too is a segue to a larger issue that we need to address as followers of Christ, and that is war. War. I wonder if Jesus was a pacifist. That would be an interesting conversation at coffee hour this morning. Think about that for a moment. John Wesley, our father of faith, tradition of the United Methodist, detested war. He wrote these words, there is no plainer proof of depravity of individuals and the degeneracy of the nations than the pursuit of war. Such acts of violence clearly shows the universal seriousness of sin. And then there's our social principles of United Methodist, found in our discipline. It says, we believe war is incompatible with the teachings and examples of Christ. We therefore reject war as an instrument of national foreign policy. As disciples of Christ, we are called to love our enemies, to seek justice, and serve as reconcilers in conflict. Here again, we need to discern, how am I a citizen of this nation called to be a peacemaker when there's so many wars going on in this country and some in which we are participating in? We can pray for peace. Though again, if Bill Caldwell once said, we pray for peace, but we pay for war. So what a cost. In terms of priorities, of human sacrifice. There was one young person in the youth group when I was here who was killed in Iraq. Phil Frank. Young person. Used to sit up in the valley and kill. I hold these men and women who do serve in the armed forces with deep honor, I do, truly. But too, I'm deeply troubled by our nation's long reliance on war. War is humanity's most chronic and incurable disease. As Plato said, only the dead have seen an end to war. And then the historian Will Durant estimated that in all human history, only 29 years in all of history can be described as free from war. Of all the centuries, this one just passed sets the record for bloodletting. When we think about that, it just seems at times it's war is a long way off. It's a long way off. Peace, that is, I mean. Jeremiah lamented, we look for peace, but no peace came. But we who are called to be peacemakers, we can't give up on it. Because to give up on peace is really to give up on God. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
I'm going to join or ask you as before we sing the last hymn to turn in your hymnals to page 886. Let's stand as we share this together for those who are able to stand. And this is a World Methodist Social Affirmation found on page 886. I invite you again to stand as we share that. We believe in God, creator of the world and of all people, and Jesus Christ, incarnate among us, who died and rose again, and the Holy Spirit present with us the guide, strength, and comfort.
We believe in God, the Father.
We rejoice in every sign of God's kingdom, in the holding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation. In each act of self-giving on behalf of others and in the abundance of God's good gifts, entrusted to us that all may have enough in all responsible use of the earth's resources.
Glory to God on high, and on earth peace.
We confess our sins, individual and collectively, by silence or action, through the violation of human dignity based on race, class, sex, age, nation, faith, through the exploitation of people because of greed and indifference, through the misuse of power, personal, communal, national, international life, through the search for security by those military and economic forces that threaten human existence through the abuse of technology, which endangered the earth and all the life that's on it.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
We commit ourselves individually and as a community to the way of Christ, to take up the cross, to seek abundance life for all humanity, to struggle for peace with justice and freedom, to risk ourselves in faith, hope, and love, praying that God's kingdom may come.
Amen.